Our Land by Johan Runeberg became the Finnish national anthem in 1846 with music by Frederick Passius. Every gathering that celebrates traditional holidays like Independence Day, Kalevala Day, and Vappupäivä, May 1st, begins with a group sing of both Maamme and the Star Spangled Banner.
Humble people, our God against the powers of barbarism and darkness is humanity's own endless struggle for light and life. Sakarias Topelius. The Finnish people and the Finnish language have a splendid and proud past. The Finnish national anthem, Maamme, gives a hint of Finland's budding nationalism and encouraged nationalism peacefully. Oh, our homeland, Finland, your golden words ring clear. No valleys, no mountaintops, no waters or shores are as dear as in our homeland, this northern country of our fathers. Your teachings will once again burst forth from its shell, and yet it raises our love for your hopes and joys, and once again the song of our fatherland will ring with the highest echo. Finland has embraced the democratic virtues and cherished principles of liberty, equality, and fraternity that are embodied in our Declaration of Independence, July 4, 1776, in the French Revolution of 1789, and in the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights. A Finnish descendant, John Morton, whose family name was originally Martinen, was a signer of the United States Declaration of Independence. He was a surveyor from Ridley, Pennsylvania, and died in April 1777.
John Morton cast the deciding vote that gave the United States its Declaration of Independence.
The Finnishness of the Kalevala and our ancient beautiful language. Finnish identity is tied to the Finnish language. In true folklore tradition, the Finnish people sang themselves into existence through the Kalevala. It is the shaper of our language. It is the inspirer of our independence. And it has been the source of the flowering of our art and literature. It is the symbolization of the deep Finnish past, which has provided a guide to the modern development of our culture. Music can speak universally, but to appreciate the literature of another country demands a thorough knowledge of the language. All Finns are literate.
Now we continue with very old traditional tunes from Karelia. Next one is a song from Kalevala. A song about Väinämöinen, main hero of Kalevala, who is a great singer, wizard, and kantala player. The name of the song is Väinämöinen ja Vene. Väinämöinen and the boat. Thank you.
Between 1829 and 1835, Elias Lönnrot collected and transcribed the oral epic Kalevala. Eino Freiberg, born in Finland, came to America as a child and settled in Westminster, Massachusetts. He is the first native-born Finn to do a complete English verse translation of the Kalevala.
Tervetuloa. On behalf of the Finnish North American Literature Society and Raivaaja Publishing Company, I'd like to welcome you all to this festive occasion, the 90th birthday or celebration of Eino Freiberg, or should I say Eino Friberg, the true Finnish name. Happy birthday, Eino. Onneksi olkoon.
You can say it anyway.
We praise him highly for his greatest work, a matter of giving us a wonderful Finnish-inspired translation of the Kalevala. What a formidable task. Again, picture Eino listening to the original Kalevala poems, putting them into Braille form, reading them over and over, line by line, in order to get the deep sense of the meaning of the words and their combinations and their particular alliterations. Then, line by line, testing the English translation until he found each line to express the sense of the Finnish words. This is real translation. That is translating from one language, one idiom, one sense of civilization to another, and being familiar with each. Not what is otherwise called a dictionary translation, as others have done. I recall beginning to read the Freiberg translation a few years ago. Almost immediately, everything I had read before fell into place. I felt at home again. It was and is a great gift to have this new and real translation published for all of us. Eino's translation clearly reveals the pains and joys of the Kalevala story and puts these pains and joys into readable, enjoyable, and if I can use the word feelable, English that reaches deep into the souls of every Finn and digs out all those long forgotten memories carried down from generation to generation. His translation comes from the sounds in his heart and the memories and experiences of his senses and truly captures the essence of being there in the age of the Kalevala. Well, we're here today not only to praise Eino for his accomplishments and ventures, but also to celebrate his birthday. Eino, we all wish you the best of everything on this auspicious day in celebration of your 90th birthday. We are proud of you as a Finn and as an American. We congratulate you for and take pride in your many accomplishments under the circumstances given to you by fate. You have demonstrated to us and personified the word sisu. Eino, you have real sisu. Sisu vahvempi kuin susi. To us, you are a Finnish John Milton, a real Finnish Renaissance man. We're all proud to have you as our friend. Happy birthday to you, Anna.
And I want to leave you with these few little Finnish words. Nuoruus ei ole mikään varma ikäraja. Se on mielen tila. Olet niin nuori kuin uskosi, itse luottamuksesi, toivosi ja niin vanha kuin epäilysi, pelkosi ja epäusko.
Finnish meter is not a regular meter to begin with. It was made up spontaneously by runo singers, and sometimes they changed names, changed verses, and all this. It was a spontaneous repetition of the traditional stories. They may go back 200-300 years, of 200-300, two or 3,000 years, maybe more than that, that these very stories were told, but they got mixed up in the names and the events, of course. Somebody added something, and the next one dropped out something, but we got the essence of it. And the essence in the Kalevala is that singing is the greatest value for mankind. And the singing, of course, is not only singing, but if you read through the Kalevala and notice something that is very little talked about, it is an infusion of tenderness and love. And today is Mother's Day, and pretty soon it'll be Memorial Day, when we have to remember. And I have to tell you a story about my mother, something that she did. I'll tell you about the Kalevala mother warrior. We were very poor, living on farm, and one Christmas, my brother Wayne, wanted skates very badly. His brother crying, skates. My mother didn't have any money. The neighbor's calf died, and they took the carcass into the woods in the middle of the winter and couldn't bury it. My mother went out and skinned that calf and sold the hide to a man who at that time bought hides, cow hides, and so on, and bought the skins. Now that's a heroic thing for a mother. Not very many mothers could do it, but mothers will do things like that for their children. And in the Kalevala, you find a great appreciation and praise of mothers. That's the most outstanding one is the mother of Lemminkäinen, Now, this Lemminkainen falls down the rapids or the falls of Tuonela, and the son of Tuoni down in the lower region in the caverns of the dead. Tuoni's son chops him into 8 pieces and more, and the mother gets and throws him into the Black River down there. It's what the Greeks would call the Styx. It's and then the black swan, by the way, who goes crooning away there to make the change the picture. Anyway, this was done. She took a rake about, it was 500 fathoms long, so 500 fathoms, 500 times 6, that's how many feet it was she had, and she raked up the pieces of her son and put him together again. This great thing which your mother would do. And then you have Lemminkainen's mother protecting him and telling him where to go to hide. She finds a hiding place in 28, because he had in a duel killed the master of Pohjola, and he had to flee, and she found him a place to go and be in safety. And then in other places you have a reference to a mother, the mother of all, the primal mother. It's a creatrix, the mother creatrix. And the feeling is that the greatest character in the Gulliver is not Väinämöinen, it is not Ilmarinen, it is not Lemminkainen, and it isn't Louhi. It is the mother. It is the mother. And I think not very many people have seemed to recognize that fact. It is the mother, and the mother creates. And then Ilmatar, she's the virgin of the air, and she's the one who apparently was the mother of Väinämöinen. And the interesting part of it is when Väinämöinen was born, there's a description of it there. And one morning, the 24th of April, I got a telephone call from the Finnish embassy in Washington, and they asked me for a quotation from my translation. Now, who do you think that quotation was for? Who was it for?
President Bush.
President Bush, yes. Guide the traveler to his land. Child of mankind, to the open, to behold the moon in heaven, and to wonder at the daylight, get to know the great bear's grandeur, or then just to stare up at the stars. Thanks.
Thank you.
High drama and magical adventurings prevail in the Kalevala, but much is rooted in everyday life and domesticity. It has elements of the Book of Genesis and of the Book of Revelation. In it are many beginnings. There is an interpretation of the geographical beginnings, of the colonial beginnings, and the beginnings of Christianity. It is the crystal in which nationality is mirrored. Traditionally, Kalevala Day is celebrated with music and readings.
At the end of the last century, the majority of Finns were farmers. The seasonal changes in the farmers' work rule the rhythm of life. The passage of time was marked by the important dates in the farming season, with the year's feast days being a combination of church holidays and celebrations connected with farming. The early immigrants continued to farm and maintain the celebrations.
The date is pre-1835. This house probably closely resembles the way it looked 150 years ago. A shed attaches the barn to the house and in the early days provided shelter for the farmer when he went to do his chores in bad weather. The earliest known owner was William Bemis, a blacksmith. The early maps indicate that there was a blacksmith shop located at this site for at least 70 years. Michael Day acquired the property in 1843. He is said to have been the first Irishman who settled permanently in Westminster. A later occupant was L.M. Bassett. Schoolhouse number 3 was located on Bolton Road at the junction of West Princeton and Bolton Roads.
Bob Mason, this is the foundation of the of a blacksmith shop that might have been sitting right in this location. There's a couple of buildings that were on the old maps. A lot of it might have been ruined and a lot of the stonework has been gone. But you still see the remains of the edge of the ground level foundation. I doubt if there was a cellar here.
There's only a few stones left right here that most of them have been removed and made into the stone wall. This was the first schoolhouse, but it was on ground level. As you can see, there's nothing left of it. So,
the Finns introduced to America their convenient way of felling trees, and they built hay barns out of logs, as they had done for centuries in their homeland. Coming mainly from farms, most of them sought political freedom and the chance to make a better way of life. Armed with a tenacity called sisu, the Finns turned their eyes toward America in their search for the good life, and the lifelong struggle has left its imprint on their character. Sisu means what must be done will be done. It's no use to count the cost.
The main reasons for leaving Finland were economic, and the beginning of Russification made the future outlook cloudy in the eyes of many. The men worked in a small pulp mill on River Street, or in the quarries on Rollstone Hill in Fitchburg. The women, hard-working and immaculate housekeepers, found work as domestics or in the mills. New experiences and the need for mutual assistance inspired the early immigrants to form their own church congregations, Finnish halls, and a few literary groups. The Finnish Farmers' Society of Hubbardston, Mass. Was formed for the sole purpose of establishing a social reading room and library.
My great-grandfather, Asa LeCoult, settled here in 1894. He was born in Finland, and he first came to this country and worked the railroads in Ohio, and then went back to Finland, and then decided to come back and settled in Maynard, Massachusetts, and later in 1894 he came to Hubbardston. So he was one of the first Finns to settle in Hubbardston. My grandfather settled here, lived here all his life, and my dad, who passed away 3 years ago at 88 years old, he lived all his life here. And basically, Hubbardston is primarily a Finnish community. And we lived on a family farm and kind of grew up, we raised all our vegetables and cattle. And in fact, one time they had like 300 horses and cattle at this farm, which burnt down in 1914. And in 1915, they built the farm that's at the site as to this day. When my great-grandfather, Asa, came to Hubbardston, he was in the logging business. Back then, if you wanted to log the trees off of a piece of land, you had to buy the land and then cut the trees, and you got stuck with a piece of land with pretty much open fields. And originally, there was 300 acres of land that my great-grandfather owned in Hubbardston at one time. I have a bottle here, milk bottle, the United Co-op Society, Maine and Mass. And, it's one of the early milk bottles that the co-op had for their milk. He also had a blacksmith shop on this farm where he shoed horses and made some of the tools for the farm. And I have a piece here, this is a fork that was made in his blacksmith shop. It's one of the few I got. I have another one on the wall here, and other primitive type tools that actually he made right here in Hubbardston. This is the naturalization papers where Asa LeCoult became an American citizen in 1906. My great-grandfather, Asa LeCoult, and four other men were the founders of the Finnish Farmers Society here in Hubbardston for the purpose of establishing, maintaining a place for reading rooms, libraries, social meetings in Hubbardston, Massachusetts. This was the fork that was stuck into the hayload on the wagon, and it was pulled up into the hayloft. And then the rope was pulled to drop the hay into where they wanted it. And the stained glass window came from the First Baptist Church in Westminster, which was built in 1837.
Nearly every member of the Finnish community in Fitchburg was associated with a church, temperance group, or with the Saima Labor Society, which was founded in 1894 by a dissident group, Temperance Society. Each group upheld the vision of a better life.
The first Finnish organizations, Aamunkoitto Temperance Society, the Messiah Lutheran Congregation, and Saima Labor Society, joined forces to buy the first Finn Hall, dedicated in 1900. In 1906, Saima built its own hall on the corner of Foster and Layton Streets and may have been the largest first-generation organization in the United States in the 1920s and 30s. Saima Hall was sold in 1957, but up to that time, it was the Finnish community center for Fitchburg and its surrounding countryside. Saima Society built a hall as a meeting place for its social and cultural activities. The auditorium seated 700 people, which included a 50-seat balcony. Theater was well equipped so that all kinds of stage productions could be held here. The auditorium seats were removable so that the place could be used for dances and other affairs. Band, orchestra, choral groups, and drama group, folk dance groups were all formed. I was a member of the theater group from the age of about 7. They put on children's plays and encouraged us to continue. It also helped in keeping up my Finnish language, acting in these Finnish plays for many years, ending up in the 50s as directing. However, that activity has forced an end because we have no longer Finnish-speaking actors to do a good play. One of the best things that I recall is the fact that we had professional directors that taught us, professional directors coming from Finland. And I remember one in particular when I was in my 20s, a woman who was the director of the National Theater in Helsinki had been hired in New York for a year by the Finnish group and was loaned to Fitchburg for one play, and I was fortunate to be in it.
In the 1890s, working men formed the Saima Aid Society, which assisted the poor and provided sickness, accident, and funeral benefits. Many Finns gravitated to the bread-and-butter socialism of the day. They supported unions, but did not favor violence or revolutionary tactics. They believed change should come through the orderly process of legislation. Long before the 8-hour day, workmen's compensation, unemployment insurance, Medicare, and old age pensions became the law of the land. The Finns advocated such proposals. The Finns are open-minded about many things, especially in the area of women's rights.
On the occasion of the 90th anniversary of the year Finnish women gained the right to vote and hold elected office in 1906, the first woman appointed Consul General of the Finnish Consulate in New York City spoke about women's voting rights at the Finnish Center at Saima Park. Until 1906, men who didn't own land in Finland also could not vote, and women who had received the vote in Finland in 1906 could not vote in the United States until 1920.
90 years for the furtherance of Finnish culture and tradition is a very significant achievement from any point of view. And by the number of people present here today, I can very well see in my own eyes that the tradition is still very much alive and doing well. The political rights of women 1906 were no gift from heaven, but they were really a result of hard and arduous work. You know, traditionally, Finnish women had always worked hard alongside men on the farms. You know, Finland was a very agricultural society and rural society, and had always had to share all the tasks and responsibilities. In the hard Finnish climate, when the weather permitted, everybody, men and women alike, had to go to the fields. and do all their farm chores that had to be done. I wonder, by the way, how many of you here present have heard of this from your parents or even had some kind of personal experience of this. Undoubtedly, one of the key contributors to women's prominent positions in Finland is education. It seems to me that few nations in the world appreciate and put so much emphasis on formal education as we Finns do. To start with, as you might be aware of, we Finns can take pride of practically 100% of literacy for the past century. To a great part, this is thanks to early efforts of the Finnish Lutheran Church. You know, it was a well-known story that boys could not get married before they could read and write, and that was an incentive. Thus, in this light, when we think of it this way, it is all not that surprising that Finns are the world's most avid readers of newspapers. Finns read more newspapers than any other nationalities in the world. And we are also the most ardent borrowers of books from public libraries in the world. Like Consul was mentioning, my previous posting was Santiago de Chile. And there I often had to give comments and a few speeches, you know, on the position of women. And always they were asking about the famous Latin machos and how I could, as a Finnish woman, could tolerate them. So I used to answer that the famous Latin machos and the Finnish machos, for that matter, are creations of their mothers, because after all, it is women who predominantly educate the children. And furthermore, it is up to us women to encourage, first of all, and then to elect women to positions of responsibility. You see, putting equality into practice, it is not just a legal matter, but a question of attitudes. We need more understanding between men and women and more cooperation in order to change these attitudes.
In this country, it is so easy for people to forget their roots, and it is exceedingly important that we not only celebrate our oneness as Americans, but also to celebrate at the same time the uniqueness of our various ethnic origins, that all of us, as we all come from different parts of this world and have become Americans. So I think it's extremely important to see you who have kept this tradition together in this one of the key roots of Finnish-American culture here in the United States. There are several others, as you know.
Efforts to organize the Finnish community continued in the opening decades of the 20th century and was invigorated by the labor movement. Young Finns in Fitchburg, who believed society would be better served by socialism, yearned for a voice to express their beliefs. They established the newspaper Raivaaja, the Pioneer, in 1905, which grew in 6 years from a weekly to a daily. It remained a daily until 1953, when the Saturday edition was dropped. It became then the voice of the Finnish-American League for Democracy, formed by Saima and 20 other Finnish labor groups.
In 1908, a Knights and Ladies of Kalevala Society was established in Fitchburg to promote the preservation of Finnish culture and to encourage harmony within the immigrant community. In 1969, the society introduced a course in the Finnish language in the Kalevakoti on Mechanic Street to help grandchildren of Finnish immigrants who were losing touch with their cultural heritage.
The Kaleva Society started the Finnish classes in 1969, and they continue to this day. My name is Rauni Kodi, and I have been an instructor in these classes for many years. A financial grant from Finland has enabled the society to sustain these classes. The lessons are held Monday evenings from 7 to 9 p.m. along with a coffee break, which includes homemade Finnish coffee bread. The classes consist of three levels, beginners, intermediate, and advanced. And they are held at a 10-week course in the spring and the fall. They have been proven to be a wide variety of people showing interest in the Finnish language. They range from doctors, teachers, and ministers to college and high school students. People have traveled from all over New England to attend these classes, even as far away as from Cape Cod. These students also have a wide variety of reasons to take these classes. Some have Finnish spouses, others are planning a trip to Finland, and some just wish to take the challenge of learning this difficult but beautiful language. It has taken a great deal of time and effort and work to run these classes, but they have proven to be worthwhile and the results have been truly great. This building is the Kaleva Koti on 107 Mechanic Street, Fitchburg, Mass. It's owned by the Lodge, who purchased it from Samuel Sari, who was a building contractor, in November 1925.
Raivaaja really has been part of the summer festival ever since its beginning. Raivaaja was started in 1905 by the immigrants who had arrived from Finland and had a need to find information with their own language. They were educated, minded people, but they did not have the English language skills, so they started the Finnish newspaper, because Raivaaja's mission has always been that, to educate, to inform and to stimulate, to teach you about the new country in the early part of the century. Today, of course, our mission of education is still here, but now we are sort of reversed, because we are also giving information in English language to the future generations of the early immigrants who do not have Finnish skills. But because the material is in Finnish, we provide it for them in English form so they can learn about their own past.
Raivaaja is a non-organization. Its mission has always been education, not profit. And it is overseen by a volunteer board of directors who are chosen by the member shareholders in an annual meeting. And the owner really is the Finnish-American community, individuals and organizations, corporations. So the membership is open to everybody. And the whole purpose is to provide information. Besides publishing the newspaper, we also act as a clearinghouse for anything Finnish or Finnish-American. Scholars, students, both Finns and non-Finns turn to us when they need some information about Finnish America or Finland, and we try to steer them to the right direction if we can't provide the information ourselves.
The first summer festival was held in North Weymouth in 1907. It featured a parade, speakers, music, food, dancing, gymnastics, and sporting events. Over the years, the events have remained the same, but until the 1940s, the site moved from community to community. The first main speaker was a Captain Koch, who escaped from Helsinki dressed as a woman, and for a short time lived in Lunenburg, Massachusetts. By 1910, Fitchburg was said to have the largest Finnish colony in the United States.
In 1912, the Saima Society bought a 32-acre abandoned farm on Scott Road and developed it into Saima Park. Well, here we are at Saima Park in Fitchburg, which was purchased by the Finns in 1912. On June 13, 1912, the Finnish newspaper had an item which read, "All Saima members are called to attend a meeting next Sunday evening at Saima Hall to decide definitely on the purchase of a certain tract of land. This land, which is being considered for purchase, is only about 10 to 15 minutes walking distance from the watering trough at the end of Mechanic Street. Before this purchase can be made, however, there are certain important matters to be discussed, as everyone is urged to attend the meeting. Those who'd like to inspect the property may do so next Sunday on their way to the Athletic Club track meet at Cattle Hill, since the land is near there." So, the very next week, the deed was signed on June 19, 1912, and the following Sunday, June 24th, they had their first picnic here. These are the people from the Saima Society. They had a hall in Fitchburg on Layton Street, but they wanted to have a place for their summer activities in such a place as this. So, the first picnic brought 2,000 people, and they had a little program, which was usually band music. The Fitchburg Saima Band played music, several numbers, and the young people called Ihanelito, a young group, made the rest of the program. It doesn't say what they did, but anyway, they performed. So that everybody was very pleased with this place. Now, when they bought it, there were 26 acres, but later the Saima, we have acquired six more acres, so that now this is a 32-acre place. Now the building, there was a seven-room house here when they bought the property, and it was leased to a family for 5 years, and they took care of the area and also paid a small rental. A few years after acquiring the property, the house burned, and leaving only two rooms, which are two rooms that are attached to this building, right in back of me. The additional building was built a few years later. So immediately they began to make improvements in the place. A lot of the brush was cleared, and a small building, outdoor theater, was built, which was used primarily for dancing, and they did some plays. One of them mentioned was A Midsummer Night's Dream. That building was destroyed by 1920, just from the winters, cold winters, and so a new building was built in 1924, a dance hall, and this was a much sturdier building. Also, it included a stage so that plays could be performed here, although the major portion of the theater was still in Fitchburg in their hall on Layton Street. The brook was dammed so that we could have a swimming pool. Swimming pool was constructed. Now, it was constantly in use, and there were Red Cross life-saving lessons here, and it was a really popular place in the summer. A well was installed, instigated by Mr. Henry Puranen, who was a member of the organization and business manager of the Raivaaja. To build, in order to supplement dry summers when the pool's water would abate, and however, they could never get that well to pump. There was something wrong with the pump, and so it began to be called the Puranen's Folly for many, many years. However, in 1964, they somehow got the thing going, and it was used for quite a while until the pool was no longer used. Now, a lot of the construction work has been done by professionals, but a great deal of it was done by volunteers, as it still is today. And in 1977, the dance hall burned, and a new building was constructed. And this is a year-round building still standing today, which we call our clubhouse.
Here I am at the old stairs that led to the hall that used to hold the dances. How I remember as a child, as a kid, coming here every Saturday. Couldn't wait for that Saturday to come so I could come here and dance. And sometimes we had orchestras from Finland, and no matter who was playing, it was very important to come here and dance. I've always loved dancing. We as Vermontula dance group, our folk dance group, which I'm a part of, we danced here several times. And it makes me a little bit of sad, melancholy, seeing these stairs, because that's all that's left of the hall. I hope someday we'll be able to build another summer hall like this one was. It certainly was the best place for me at the time, as a young adult growing up.
The Saima Society was a source of education, entertainment, and sociability for immigrant families struggling to build new lives in a strange land. There emerged a Saima band, Saima chorus, Saima drama club, and the Raipus Athletic Club. Raipus means alert or perky.
I have been a member of Raivaaja ever since I was old enough to join, and that was at 6 years of age. I was so thrilled when I turned six and could go down the hill to the Raivaaja building where the Raivaaja gym was located on the very top floor, and with my 25 cents and become a member. And I just loved it. It was just great. We exercised with women's exercises or girls' exercises, the old calisthenics with no music, all the uksikaksi, you know, and the counting. And it was just the thing that was a highlight of our week, to go down to the gym twice a week. The instructors were super, and they were all volunteers. We usually didn't go to the gym until about 4 or 5 o'clock because the young fellas came from work to come to teach us. There was apparatus of all kinds in the gym and a racetrack around the perimeter. The boys had a wonderful gymnastics team with the parallel bars, and they had a wrestling area. They had the steel rings that we used to swing on just for fun, and the horse and just everything, the climbing ropes, and there were little lockers and some showers. So that those were wonderful days. We also had March meets later on, but I'll talk about Saima Park now, where we are. When I was a little girl, this was still called Saima Farm, but later on it was turned to Saima Park. This pond was a busy place for swimming. I was lucky in my family because my mother loved to swim. So of course we had no automobile. So we would walk up here every day from way up Nutting Street and bring some of the other neighborhood children too and get acclimated to the water. And then a little bit later, when Henry Puranen was teaching Red Cross life-saving classes here, that's where I took lessons and enjoyed all the hard work that we had to do. I can remember the difference in CPR there. We used to straddle each other with the victim lying on the ground, and we'd push on the back on the near the rigged area and say, out goes the bad air, and then release and say, in comes the good. And we would do this hoping to revive the victim. So there have been a lot of changes in aquatics since those days. There was the big locker room here. It seems to me it was longer than it is now. And there were cement steps that came down from it where we usually went into the water. And the water, by the way, was ice cold. It came from the brook, and if the water had been so low that when there was no rain, then they had an electric pump and would pump well water into the pond. So that was even colder then. There was also a cement big, what we called a float, but it really wasn't a float because it didn't float. And then across from that was a 26-foot high diving tower. There were three what we call flights there. There wasn't any diving board that I recall on there, but people did more platform diving. The top deck was a nice place to take sun. And for years, I measured distances at 26 feet at Saima Farm, top deck, and I would figure that's about, you know, what the length of something might be. The locker room was great. We would come in and pay 10 cents for a locker, and we'd get a key. There would be a few items for sale, field goodies, soft drinks, and also some candy and things like that.
Athletic Club continues their annual track and field events at the Kesäjuhla, the summer festival, held on or near the 4th of July weekend. This century end marks their 93rd celebration year.
Physical fitness, including health, has been a part of the Finnish way of life ever since the year one. Here at Saima Park, we have had the Raivaaja Athletic Club since 1903. and they have had annual meets. Today was the 85th annual track and field meet that was sponsored by the Raivaaja Athletic Club. And I have some trophies from years gone by from some of the accomplishments of our previous members of the Raivaaja Athletic Club. This one here in particular is kind of nice. It was a three-year trophy, and it was 2 years of it was won by the women from the Raivaaja Athletic Club. This was for a 400-meter relay race, and it was won in 1917 and 18 by the Fitchburg Raivaaja Athletic Club members, and finally in 1919 by the Worcester Finns. Here on my right-hand side is a second-place trophy that was won by the men's basketball team at a tournament in 1933. And this one here is very interesting in that this was awarded for freestyle calisthenics. In those years, people had a uniform and they would go out on an open field and they would perform calisthenics in unison, and it was not uncommon to see hundreds of people out there, pretty much like our nowadays aerobics, only it was done outside as opposed to inside like aerobics is done. Now, the tradition of Finns and athletics and health and fitness continues. We have at Saima Park a cross-country ski trail system, and it's now lighted so that we can enjoy skiing both daytimes and nights. And we have races here, our own sponsored races, and we also host the Massachusetts Senior Cross Country Championships each year, and in conjunction with the Council on Aging. Again, a part of this physical fitness that the Finns really believe in. Today we have the Frank Lorkala Award for the most outstanding performance overall at our 85th Raivaaja Athletic Club track and field meet here at Saima Park. Frank was a outstanding person in that he maintained athletics to a high degree here at Saima Park. He was a manager, coach, and director. Also, we have another award, the Erkki Koutonen Award for the most outstanding performance in jumping events here again at this track meet. Erkki Koutonen was an outstanding Finnish athlete. He went to the 1948 Olympics and represented the United States in the long jump, the high jump, and the triple jump. And this event is in his memory.
A guy who really, Doug, was the father of track here at Fitchburg High, Erkki Koutonen.
Yeah, Erkki Koutonen was a wonderful gentleman that passed away a few years ago, but he has left his mark here on Fitchburg High School and the students who had the opportunity to run for him in track. Erik was a wonderful man who grew up in Finland. We are very fortunate. He was a triple jump performer, a world-class athlete, and fortunately for Fitchburg, he came to Fitchburg and became a teacher and a coach. And for years, he coached our cross-country team, our indoor track, and our outdoor track team.
Kun minä vien sen markkinoille, hevosetkin nauraa. Hei luulia, ha ha ha, hevosetkin nauraa. Hei luulia, ha ha ha, hevosetkin nauraa. Hilu, 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 kun tuli vilu tuolla Kynttilän valakialla. Hilu, 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 kun tuli vilu tuolla Kynttilän valakialla. Vaikka heila etu polvella keinuis tuolissa kammarin lattialla. Vaikka heila etu polvella keinuis tuolissa kammarin lattialla. Kilikissä sametissä mirunarukengät oli entisellä heilallani. Kilikissä sametissä mirunarukengät oli entisellä heilallani. Ja enkä mä häntä riannut kuin ilman pilkallaan. Ja enkä mä häntä riannut kuin ilman pilkallaan. muoria vaadinut. Ja silloin ne pojat kylän lähti, kun muoria vaadinut.
Kuti, 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 vensaa!
Brochures, the logos, the sweatshirts, the stationery, and so on. Without him, I don't know what we would have done.
Athletic events out there. Those athletic events have been going on since our first generation Finns. My mother and father and so many other first generation Finns came over here and started dramatic groups and performing groups and bands and choruses and athletics. Oh, they had the Raivaajas, and that was the beginning. We were a feeder group to all of the basketball teams at the Fitchburg High School. Wonderful thing. And that's why so many of those people, the second generation, and even of the third now, are interested in athletics. I believe that whole spirit came from the rapist dreams that they had in the early days. And that our forefathers, when they came here from Finland, knew how important athletics and drama and all kinds of ways that people grow could come out of their food. That's what they brought to this new country. They came here, and that's what they have given. It's the heritage they have given us, and the heritage they have given to this country, this area in here.
The Saima Society was instrumental in the establishment of the United Cooperative Society. In Finland, cooperatives emerged after 1899 with government funds and university-trained leadership. In Fitchburg, the Finns had little money, no experience, and no trained leaders, only the belief that cooperation, one is able to get more out of life for others and for himself. The cooperative, a consumer-owned business based on England's Rochdale principles, is controlled by the customers who purchase moderately priced shares. Growth of the cooperatives have added to Fitchburg's industrial progress, and as their fame spread, visitors from around the world came to Fitchburg to observe the cooperatives in action.
This year's summer festival marks the 361st anniversary of the arrival of Finns in North America. In 1638, a group of Finns and Swedes settled in what is now the state of Delaware.
While in not for craving and has here the hand, on what shall the roll up to bear? Cherish the story, need a fast on your rock, still a lot of fear. See if we love the mountain of Antrim, going at sea and whom are the boys?
Hello, I'm Maya Mord, I'm co-chair for the festival this year. Welcome to the kickoff dance.
Remembering other aspects of the cultural legacy, particularly familiar folk tunes and poetry. The Finnish people have always had a great love for poetry, and so no matter where the program was held, there was always the recitation of a poem on every program. In the churches, it was of a religious nature. Among the Dries, the poem extolled the virtues of temperance, and at Saima Park in the early years, we listened to stirring socialist exhortations in verse form. There were always several recitationists in every organization, in every Finn town, who delighted to present their poems to the audience. In fact, recitationists regularly present matinees in theaters in Finland, just as a soloist might present a vocal concert in an auditorium. This interest in poetry also produced several noteworthy poets among the Finnish immigrant population, who often earned their daily bread as newspaper editors. Among the labor movement, Aku Päiviö was a very well known, as was Niku Nousio, who worked at the Raivaaja for many years. In the late 40s, when a great number of the bands and choruses of early years had died out, the vacancy on the summer festival programs was taken up by a poetry reciting contest where interested participants from various localities could present their talents in an adjudicated contest for which prizes were awarded. Certain poems were favorites of many recitationists, poems such as Alpo Noponen's Minä aikana ihminen kaunein on, which compared to virtues of various stages of one's life, or Rajan Lapsi, which spoke of the misery of a child who was born on the Russian border. In that time, after the Second World War, several young people came over from Finland who had a different way of reciting and who had a different group of poems, such as this one. It's called Alkid, and it's by Lauri Viita. He talks about life in the town of Pispala near Tampere, where the working class lived. Alfield is the name of a woman. Mothers alone, endowed with hope, see God. They're given strength and given will to climb and dream from under the cloud and look from a higher hill. Alfield, she who gave me birth, nightly sailed away from earth to where her Emily growled his say, coming and going as he did in his day. And now they walk the bright star track, father and mother, looking back at the little hill and the family home, the cats, the dogs, the people they've known, waving and calling as best they can, lest any of us trip on Beespala's stone. On a distant planet, on a garden swing, under a rowan, they linger and cling, and silently remember their light and dark as a courting couple in Tampere Park. And if it was payday, the extra fun of tucking away a coffee and bun. And when the Pispala dawn turns red, mother will come to make the bed, and the birds will trill. How wonderful to be alive and see your children's children thrive and tell your beautiful dreams as well. Oh, my children, love.
This was in a bound volume of a Finnish working magazine put out by the IWW Finns called Dear Papa, the Road to Freedom. It was a translation of a short poem by Walt Whitman. It surprised me. I've never seen a Walt Whitman poem translated into Finnish. And I thought this really expressed the feeling I got when I grew up here, that we were always very proud of our ethnicity and our achievements, our culture, but we also, the message I got through growing up around Fitchburg, and I guess I looked in the halls, was that we also felt that we weren't alone in this world, that humanity is to survive, we have to work together with peoples of all ethnicity, colors, and races, and to work for in harmony and cooperation. And Walt Whitman, to me, expresses a lot of that, the best of the American democratic tradition in the last century. And he was a very optimistic, a very enthusiastic sort of man, and everything he wrote was very large and very boundless. And I thought he expressed the best of this, and I also think that this was the kind of thing that I learned from growing up in a Finnish community. I'll read Whitman's own words, and then I'll read the translators. Unfortunately, what happened in a lot of these Finnish publications, novels were translated, plays were translated, poems, essays were translated anonymous. Nobody put their own name on it. Occasionally, initials, once in a while, a name. So this translator is unknown. I thought he did a nice job. This moment yearning and thoughtful. This moment yearning and thoughtful, sitting alone, it seems to me there are other men in other lands yearning and thoughtful. It seems to me I can look over and behold them in Germany, Italy, France, Spain, or far, far away in China or in Russia or in Japan, talking other dialects. And it seems to me, if I could know these men, I should become attached to them as I do men in my own lands. Oh, I know we should be brethren and lovers. I know I should be happy with them. Minä istutuksinani, ajatuksini vaikuneena, palavasti kaivaten. Minusta tuntuu, kun olisi muissakin maissa ajattelevia, kaipaavia ihmisiä. Minusta tuntuu, kun saavuttaisin heidät katsellani. Saksassa, Italiassa, Ranskassa, Espanjassa, kaukana Kiinassa, Intiassa, jokaisen omine vieraani kielineen. Luulen, että jos tuntisin heidät kaikki, tahtoisin mennä heidän luoksi aivan kuin oman maan ihmisten luo. Ah, minä tiedän, että tulisimme veljiksi ja sydän ystäviksi. Minä tiedän, että tulisin heidän kansan onnelliseksi.
American folklore characters like Bonnie and Clyde, Billy the Kid, and Jesse James reflect a more violent side of human nature. In the early days of the 20th century, Finland also boasted of a folk hero named Isotalon Antti, or Antti from the Big House, who was also leader of the Heju movement. And his deeds of crime are recorded in a song well known by most Finns to this day.
Something terrible is going to happen, because he's in the field that way, because he wants to do something exciting. I born in the same area, and those guys, they have like a criminal background, but they was like a heroes, because they usually those they look up some like a real strong man, and you know some you know real unusually strong, and they make a song, you know, those old days, because they don't write anything down like you know like other people.
Isontalon Antti, he was considered a hero of sorts who resided in Herme, Finland, where the rough characters fought with knives. Antti Isotalo and Järven Ranta were talking together, and Antti says to his buddy Ranta, "Why don't you kill that ugly constable, and I will wed his lovely widow? First we break the gates, and then the wall." Andy traveled first, as he was the tallest of all. Antti was the first man in the Järvi came second, and Jaska Putkinen from Kalevala was the third one. "I'll be damned," says Ranman Järvi, "if I'm afraid of any man. A can of tar smashed on the head and a knife stabbed in the back. The blood of Vasa has never trembled, and the Kalevala knives don't rust. Grab him in the neck and stab him in the back if he doesn't agree. Hip, hip, hip," says Ranna Järvi when he danced with his mare. Again, a lively boy has left his poor home. "Don't sing about Ranna Järvi anymore, because he is dead. And on his grave now stands a granite statue."
Jollei se muuten suostu. "Hepi, hepi, hepi," sanoi Rannanjärvi, kun tanssit juorittansa. "Taasen on lähtenyt koijari poika tuolla köyhästä koristansa. Ei saa laulaa Rannanjärvestä, Rannanjärvi on kuullut. Rannanjärven hauralle on marmorikivi tuutu."
We have not forgotten Karelia, the mighty hills and the shoreless lake Ladoga of the old native lands. A stranger cannot understand the whisper of Karelian forests. We have sung and played and cried and laughed, remembering Karelia.
The new immigrants, who kept arriving until World War I, helped keep alive the use of the Finnish language. Virtually all immigrants learned to use Finn English, a blend of English words with Finnish case endings. Thus, farmer became farmari.
In the Depression decade of the 1930s,
thousands of Finnish immigrants left America for Finland or Soviet Karelia. The Soviet government, with the support of left-wing groups like the Finnish Workers' Federation, was actively recruiting settlers to help develop its economy. Finns had long been attracted to Karelia, which was where the Finnish epic poem, the Kalevala, originated.
My experiences of living in Kontupohja, Karjala from 1932 to 1938. My mother, sister, and I left for New York, from New York on the ship Kungsholm in August 1932. There were over 100 passengers going to the Soviet Union, USSR. I was 16 years old at the time, and my sister Helvi was 5. Everyone felt the excitement of leaving for this wonderful country, which was supposed to be the workers' utopia. The depression was very bad in USA, and a great many people lost their jobs, as did my folks. My mother worked in a textile mill as a weaver, and my father worked in a foundry. Both mills shut down, so our family had no income.
I've become custodian of my husband's family information that has to do with an aunt of his who went to Russia in the early 1930s. She was one of 8 children who, with grandfather Isaac, came from Finland with 6 of his children, and 2 more were born here. Since that time, until Mamie Savander wrote her book, not for 60 years did the family know anything of the fate of their firstborn child, Hilma. Hilma Fori went to Russia in the 30s with her husband and left here in America 7 sisters and brothers. One sister had married her husband's brother, so they corresponded greatly for only 3 years, and in 1936 no one heard a word about them. But Mamie Savander, in her book, had the information, and when there was a family reunion in 1994, this booklet contained every piece of information about the family, and there were 400 at that reunion. Everyone was in it except Hilma, until we found that article showing that in Russia, where they had lived, he died of starvation, and she and the grandchildren died of dysentery. And it was a very, very sad time to discover it, but we couldn't have guessed otherwise.
This map was published after 1935. And the greatest number of people went over, as you know, in the 1930s or the early 30s. And those blocks on the map, they are all neighbor camps. What I want to point out is that when Finnish Americans went over to Russia, labor camps were already in full swing. But nobody had any idea that the first labor camps that appeared in Russia were in Karelia.
Part of my family left to go to Russia in the early 30s, and 1937 was the last we heard from them, and we never knew what happened. But this grand lady, with her book, has answered the questions, and they're not pretty. It's sad to say that they died in a way that we wouldn't want them to die.
People are healing. People who refused to even let me know that their family had been there. After reading the books, they have changed. They have decided that they're going to help me. I am so grateful to every person in the United States, in Finland, in Russia, who has sent me information. Without them, I couldn't have done anything. Although, as the speaker just said, you know, I've cried as many times as I've received a letter and when I've put things down for myself. My doctor comes home and says, Mother, again you've been crying. Of course I have. I've read those terrible histories, those terrible tragedies that occurred to people. I put them through my heart. And that's one thing that I told you also at the start. You had to be one of us to write those books. You couldn't be a stranger. Because sometimes I've been told, you have too much sympathy for them. Oh yes, I have respect for them. I have sympathy for them. Once I was asked, don't you hate your parents for having taken you over there? Never. I love my parents. And if there ever was an image that would have served as an example, that was my father. I'd love to be like him.
The publication of the Finnish national folk epic, the Kalevala, in 1835 made the people more conscious of their heritage. It inspired them to work harder for independence. When Tsar Nicholas was deposed in 1917, the Finns declared their independence on December 6th that same year. Both independent Finland and the Soviet Union came into being at the end of 1917. Opening the way for both was the collapse of the Russian monarchy in March of that year. Bolsheviks, headed by Lenin, seized control from a provisional government in November, and amid much revolutionary turmoil began the establishment of a Soviet state. Finland, which had been an autonomous Grand Duchy of Tsarist Russia, took advantage of the chaos to declare itself an independent nation. That declaration was made by the Finnish Parliament on December 6th, 1917, exactly 82 years ago.
I just want to say in English that as an American veteran, I salute all of the Finnish veterans.
This Russian waltz has become one of the most symbolic and popular songs of the World War II in Finland. In the silence of the night, in the warmth of the fire, the soldier remembers his girl who was left waiting in tears in her eyes. He gives an oath to see her in front of his eyes, even if his destiny is not to return. He also thinks of his mother, who is probably still awake praying and worrying for her son.
Thank you.
he always was a very strong-willed person, and he took off for the Navy when he was underage, and some man in town signed for him, and he was in the submarine service, and he was a boxer in the Navy. And then when he got out of the Navy, he came home and he did odd jobs, more or less odd jobs. And then he went into, he was very cross because he couldn't get into the Navy for World War II because he was missing some molars. And he said, I could chew. Then they drafted him. He said, how come I can chew Army food if I can't chew the Navy food, which is better than the Army food? So then, having been in the submarine service, that's where you get the best food anyway. So then he went into the Army, and before he went into the Army, he went to Finland and fought in Finland, and he was in the ski troops there. Well, everybody was all charged up about that when Russia started to attack Finland. And of course, those were his family roots. So he went with the Finnish volunteers from this area.
So that was during the Winter War, was that?
Right,
yeah.
He fought on skis. Then Harry went into the World War II Army here, and he was in the Battle of the Bulge. He was in the anti-tank corps, and he was wounded there, and he was here almost till the end when he became ill. He went to the Veterans Hospital, and they placed him in a very nice rest home in Tewksbury, really a lovely one. He was there until he got pneumonia, went back to the Veterans Hospital and died there. He came home with a very nice service at the cemetery here.
Of all the old cultural practices, the use of the sauna for bathing is undoubtedly the most common. For the Finn, a sauna routine is more than a beauty treatment. It meets a practical need, cleaning up after a hard day's work. In the old days, a Finn always built his sauna before he built his home. There's nothing like a sauna with a fresh birch twig to scrape the skin and keep the blood singing. The sauna is a tradition that is refreshing and relaxing.
Pioneers, when they came to America, the first thing they built was the sauna. And they lived in the sauna portion of it and used the sauna stove to heat the room. And the children that were born to the mother were born in the sauna because of the fact that it was more antiseptic there and cleaner, and the benches were appropriately built for birthing a child. So many young Finns in the pioneer era and the days were born in the sauna, actually born in the sauna. And the sauna means so much to the people. And I get to give you a good example about how in my early youth, how the sauna really relates to us. We had a period in Connecticut where there was tremendous thunderstorms. I mean, just tremendous thunderstorms. It was like a bad summer. And one night there was, later on we found out that there was seven separate thunderstorms that all congregated in one spot right over our farm. And I'm telling you, it was like World War III. There was just constant light and constant barrage of thunder. It was just incredible. It was so much electricity in the air that would knock us on our feet. We were huddled in the house, all huddled with our arms around each other, just because everyone was just terrorized by this terrible. It must have been like bombing, you know, from a war. It was just awful. And I was a young kid. What did we do? We all ran in the sauna. Because it's like going back to mother. You know, I mean, we could have gotten killed in the sauna just as well as in the house, but that's where we went, in our little sauna that finally my father built, you know, on the farm there. And so it was, that's just one of the things that it's like the mother of the soul of the Finnish people.
Finns appreciate life's simplest pleasures. The first hand-picked strawberries of the season, the sauna, the delicious taste of salted herring and spring potatoes, and the year's first snowfall. Finns also take a keen interest in keeping fit. That's why they ski so much and enjoy other vigorous outdoor sports.
Music is an integral part of Finnish society. Finns love to dance, and folk dancing is inseparable from folk music. The Revontulet dances continue to inspire young generations with traditional dances. The traditional dance music today is tango, polka, waltz, shawty, and mazurka. Of the traditional holidays still celebrated in America, the 1st of May, Vappupäivä, marks the coming of spring. It is the Finnish Labor Day and graduation celebration day for students.
Depending on which language you speak. The Swedish-speaking people go to Kaisaniemi, and the Finnish-speaking people go to Ulanlinna, and those who speak both, they run between those two. and I happen to be one of those running. And
children's most enduring pastimes is eating and cooking. On Christmas, the holiday meal is followed by risi puro, a dish that tastes like unsweetened rice pudding. An almond is hidden in one of the servings. Tradition says that whoever finds it will be married that year. And every event is accompanied by a coffee table and freshly baked bulla, or coffee bread.
Candles and the traditional Christmas decorations made from straw help to achieve the traditional Christmas atmosphere. The Finns enjoy giving handmade decorations, as well as hand-loomed rugs, table linens, and clothes. Every year, these items can be purchased at the Fall Tori, our open marketplace. Saima Lutheran Finnish Women's Choir complements the holiday season with traditional songs in the native language. The New Year's Eve, the Finns try to tell their fortunes by pouring melted lead into a bucket of cold water where it hardens again. The various shapes are supposed to indicate what the future will bring. The Finns are dreamers. What distinguishes Finns from other dreamers is their devotion to making their ideals a reality, their practicality, and above all, their sisu in following their star. Many of the ancient myths, pagan beliefs, and customs have been handed down from generation to generation by the storytellers and the remote singers. They have been recorded in wonderful books, such as the Gullivala, and books on folklore that furnish fascinating research material and most interesting reading.
In a city like Fitchburg, we had the usual snowball effect of certain people coming here and then writing back to their relatives, because it was a time for jobs were fairly plentiful, and they kept writing back to their relatives and friends in their home parishes, come on over here and we'll find you a job, and so on and so forth. It was really what we might like to call a snowball effect. One is very tempted to say that, well, the Finns came to Fitchburg because there were paper mills here, and since the paper industry in Finland was so coming along so well, that we can get a job there, we were experienced. But this is not really a tenable thought, because most of the immigrants, the largest portion, came from Pohjanmaa, or Bosnia, Upper Bosnia, and they were farmers. They were people who had lived all their life on a farm, and probably hadn't seen a paper mill, much less be in one. And if there's anything the Finns are noted for, it's for paying their debts.
Isä meidän, joka olet taivaissa, pyhitetty olkoon sinun nimesi, tulkoon sinun valtakuntasi, tapahtukoon sinun tahtosi myös maan päällä niin kuin taivaassa. Anna meille tänä päivänä meidän jokapäiväinen leikamme, ja anna meille meidän velkamme anteeksi, niin kuin mekin annamme anteeksi meidän velallisillemme. Äläkä saada meitä kiusaukseen, vaan päästä meidät pahasta, sillä sinun on valtakunta ja voima ja kunnia iankaikkisesti. Amen. Thank you.